Good morning. It's June 12th, Peace with Justice Sunday. It's Trinity Sunday. It's another Sunday when we are fortunate to gather together to worship and praise God. And it's the last Sunday that we will look at yet one more affirmation, this time the World Methodist Social Affirmation. It seems appropriate for us to talk about the social principles of the UMC on Peace with Justice Sunday. My message will center on the justice ideas, and many of our words will center on the Trinity, and hopefully by the end of this time together, we will have both concepts firmly in our hearts and heads. And now for our call to worship. During this call to worship, there will be a time for to stop and for you to sing. From the very whisper of creation, God poured forth love. Praise be to God for the blessings of God's love. In the fullness of time, God sent Jesus as a revelation of God's own self. Praise be to Jesus for the many ways in which he revealed God to us. When we thought all hope was lost, God offered the Holy Spirit to heal and guide us. Praise be to the Holy Spirit for guidance and inspiration. For the Trinity of Understanding, we sing praise, blessings, honor, power, and majesty to God forevermore. Amen. Our psalm today is about creation, Psalm 8. Read it when you get home. And when I look at our heavens, the work of the fingers of God, the moon and the stars, it goes on and on. What are humans that you are mindful of them? But the glorious thing is, God does care for us. Let's sing about creation now in For the Beauty of the Earth. Spirit of wisdom and hope, We witness your glory in the heavens and hear your call to us. We are sometimes overwhelmed by the thought of your compassionate care. Open our hearts this day to hear and respond in joy to your call to worship you, Holy Trinity, in this hour and in our lives. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from the book of Proverbs, chapter 8, verses 1 through 4 and 22 through 31. Does not wisdom call and does not understanding raise her voice? On the heights, beside the way, at the crossroads, she takes her stands. Beside the gates in front of the town, at the entrance of the portal, she cries out, "To you, O people, I call, and my cry is to all that live. The Lord created me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of long ago. Ages ago I set up, at the first, before the beginning of the earth. When there were no depths, I was brought forth, when there were no springs abounding with water, before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. When he had not yet made earth and fields or the world's first bits of soil, when he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep, when he made firm the skies above, when he established the fountains of the deep. When he assigned to the sea its limits so that the waters might not transgress his command. When he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was beside him like a master worker, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world and delighting in the human race." Our second reading comes from the book of Romans, chapter 5, 1 through 5, and it's being sung.
Romans 5, 1 through 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us.
And now this affirmation, the World Methodist Social Affirmation. We believe in God, creator of the world and of all people, and in Jesus Christ, incarnate among us, who died and rose again, and in the Holy Spirit, present with us to guide, strengthen, and comfort. We believe, God, help our unbelief. We rejoice in every sign of God's kingdom, in the upholding of human dignity and community, in every expression of love, justice, and reconciliation, in each act of self-giving on behalf of others, in the abundance of God's gifts entrusted to us that all may have enough, in all responsible use of the earth's resources. Glory be to God on high, and on earth be peace. We confess our sin, individual and collective, by silence or action through the violation of human dignity based on race, class, age, sex, nation, or faith, through the exploitation of people because of greed and indifference, through the misuse of power in personal, communal, national, and international life, through the search for security by those military and economic forces that threaten human existence, through the abuse of technology which endangers the earth and all life upon it. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We commit ourselves individually and as a community to the way of Christ, to take up the cross, to seek abundant life for all humanity, to struggle for peace with justice and freedom, to risk ourselves in faith, hope, and love, praying that God's kingdom may come. The kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. We are called. We are called to act with justice. Let's sing about it while we day by day remind ourselves to live in it.
Come, live in the light. Shine with the joy and the love of the Lord. We are called to be light for the kingdom, to live in the freedom of the city of God. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another. to walk humbly with God. Come, open your heart and show your mercy to all those in fear. We are called to be hope for the hopeless, so all hatred and blindness will be no more.
We are called to act for justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God.
Our gospel reading today is another video from Lumo. It covers John chapter 16, verses 12 through 15.
I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. Therefore I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you.
Mom watches old game shows. She loves the Game Show Network. And when I walk past her room, she might be watching the Match Game. There's Gene Rayburn holding a long, long microphone, and Radar from MASH is answering questions, trying to match people who are contestants, women with big hair and men wearing leisure suits. It's not exactly up-to-date TV, but she loves it. Another game she watches is a bit more modern, probably from the 90s, and it's called Chain Reaction. It's a good word game, but don't tell her I said that. She often tells me I should sit down and watch it sometimes, and I keep saying no because I could get hooked into Game Show Network pretty easily, probably. I don't have time for that. Anyway, in Chain Reaction, teams are asked to link words together into common phrases. They're given the first word and the last word of the chain, And if they do a good job getting the middle ones in there, they could win a chance to play for $10,000. Here's an example of a chain starting with wide and ending in alarm. The chain that won is this: wide open, open sesame, sesame street, streetcar, car alarm. Yay, we win! I thought of that a bit today when I read Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Hear it again from the New International Version. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So do you hear the chain sort of in there? Suffering to perseverance, to character, to hope. It's not nearly as fun as wide to alarm, because those words, suffering, perseverance, character, and hope, are not all pleasant words. Except there is this. The title in the NIV for this section I just read is called Peace and Hope. So maybe we just need to talk about it a bit more. Let's start at the top, before the chain. Since we have been justified through faith. That word justified is a good concept for Christians. It is a concept worth reviewing. Justification is the result of God's action naming us righteous because of our belief and faith in Jesus. See, it's sort of a simple process. We believe in, and God understands that we are justified. And that justification leads to peace for us. It should anyway. There is peace knowing God has justified us, and hope, but maybe not the same kind of hope as at the end of the chain, not just yet. Justification is a status of righteousness that comes to us because of God's grace, which is given to us by God because of our faith. Sort of a circular thing here. We have faith that leads to our justification, which means we have God's grace in our lives. This grace and oneness with God is the peace Paul is talking about, which leads us to feel hopeful. And hopeful, then we are probably thankful and see more clearly the ways that God is working in our lives, which leads us to be more faithful. Clearly a circle, not a chain at all. Paul goes on to say, and we boast in the hope and glory of God. We've been told not to boast. Sometimes I've heard my son say to his son, Andrew, proud, but not out loud. Paul says we can boast a bit, however, in the fact that because of our justification, which leads to this great hope, we will eventually share in the glory of God. That sort of makes sense to us. God's glory will be something that we will see clearly, feel in our hearts and souls, be able to claim in the life after this one if we are faithful in our beliefs. Follow the Lord closely, living as closely as we can to Jesus's way of life, all done by listening to the Holy Spirit who lives in us. Boast all you want about that, Paul says. But then the tide turns. We come to the links in the chain. We are to glory in our suffering. I don't like suffering. I wasn't even very sick last week, but I felt as if I was suffering, stuck at home, waiting for the shoe to drop with the two lines in the little plastic test kit, and then it did. I suffered more with trying to figure out how to do what I wanted to do and forgetting all that I had to do to do while staying home and away from people while doing it. It suffered my patience and my schedule, and I clearly know, that that isn't suffering at all. We know people who really suffer. People who have one medical thing after another. People who have medical issues that no one can successfully diagnose or treat. There are many people among us who suffer in medical ways. People suffer who lose a job and then their house needs a major repair. People who have a car accident and can't work and then can't afford another car. People who have to deal with unfaithful spouses or friends. We could continue naming things that are truly things which would bring suffering. Paul doesn't mean we should glory in all that we are suffering and start a big pity party. Paul wants us to know that in and through the suffering, we still have Jesus. We need to hold on to our faith in Jesus, and we can because of God's justification, and that we should still believe that he is with us in the suffering. We recognize that we share in the suffering that Jesus endured for us, and our suffering isn't going to be anything like his. We could surely be thankful for that. And we need to remember that both Paul and the other Christians at this time were dealing with the suffering of persecution and oppression. The Romans' occupation made life miserable for the early Christians. That kind of suffering is primary in Paul's mind. We don't have that kind either, but we all suffer. The actual conditions of life, especially for believers in the midst of a worldly society, and lately we've seen far too many examples of suffering caused by a few to so many. Those conditions are not easy or pleasant, but the knowledge of acceptance in God's eyes, of grace constantly supplied, and of the prospect of the future glory all help us to continue in the face of suffering. We don't like it. We even hate it. But we can go through it with God's love. Then Paul says suffering produces perseverance. Some versions say endurance. That's the attitude and practice of keeping on. Many theologians believe that trials, tribulations, difficulties, struggles are used by God to help us develop Christ-like character. That may be true, which then explains the whole refining fire thing we read about in the Bible or the verses about being pruned. And there was no one more perseverant than Christ. He kept on right up to his death. We are reminded to work on enduring faith, even in the suffering. And when we do, we are becoming more Christ-like. Of course, one good way to endure in the struggles is to pray a lot. Turn to Christ. Perseverance leads us to develop better character. We have words for people who don't persevere or endure. We sometimes call them quitters. Quitters aren't the same as losers. Losers in the traditional sense of the word, not the loser like that. Losers went to the end. They persevered at something, but they didn't win. But they kept at it. Quitting is the opposite of perseverance and endurance, but we know the feeling we have when we get to the other side of something, when we've endured. We are different people than when we started, and for a bit, we are a winner. We learn something about ourselves in the doing, in the enduring. And that character, that one that is us at the end of the trial, that character has hope. We have hope because we have lived through the trial, faithful to God, hopeful in his salvation, justified by his grace, and holding on to the love we know he has for us. So let's hook this up a bit to two things. First, the Trinity. God is the one who justifies us. God's love and grace come to us when we choose to live in his love. Jesus was the example for us to follow, to learn the ways to endure persecution and suffering. And Jesus is the example of the character we should be developing. And the Holy Spirit, it's right there in Paul's words. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. The Trinity. And the second thing for hooking to is the affirmation for today and this Sunday, Peace with Justice Sunday. I read this. We rejoice in every sign of God's kingdom, in the upholding of human dignity and community, in every expression of love, justice, and reconciliation, in every act of self-giving on behalf of others, in the endurance and abundance of God's gifts entrusted to us that all may have enough. Just those few phrases are enough for us to realize that even though we rejoice in it, it's not happening in the world today. Human dignity is being bombed in Ukraine. There's no love or reconciliation as we hear of another shooting every few days. The abundance of God's gifts so that everyone will have enough is not happening. Many live in poverty, in food deserts, in places where adequate water or medical care isn't a possibility. Their suffering and endurance is far harder than what we experience. Let's look again at the chain of words in this next part that I said. Violation of human dignity, exploitation of people through the misuse of power, through the search for security, through the abuse of technology. That chain is evident in many places in the world, right from here in our small towns, when we can see abuse or neglect or misuse of power, to the world arena where we feel so powerless to help. But I should think that Paul's idea of endurance producing character means that we should do what is humanly possible
to assure that we do not commit the sin of silence when we see these things happening. It's Christ's character to bring light to the darkness. It's our job as the faithful, justified people of God to try our best to do the very same. If our lives are nearly perfect, we need to look around to see where suffering exists. If our efforts are one and done, we are not persevering. If our characters aren't growing day by day to be more like Christ, we don't rightly deserve peace or hope. It's Peace with Justice Sunday, and we know that if Christ were still walking on this earth with us, he would be giving us the example of justice for all. Justice for all, something else we say that we believe. Until there is peace and hope for each child of God, we have work to do. We need to persevere, using the best parts of our character to make this happen. Let's do more than hope that life will improve for all God's children. Let's do our parts. Let it be so.
Let us pray. God of creation, Jesus Redeemer, Holy Spirit, who guides and sustains us, hear our prayers this day. We know the many ways in which we have failed to do the tasks which you have set before us. We have often chosen our comfort over service. Our fears and doubts lay claim to our lives, and we shrink from the opportunities you give to us. Forgive us for the many failings. Lift and restore us to your grace. Put our feet on the pathways of service, offering justice and peace to all people. Help us, O gracious one, so we follow the chain from suffering to hope, and so that we can help others to do the same. Lord of mysteries, we admit that sometimes we are confused by the concept of Trinity. We can speak the words of three in one, but our minds are boggled and confused. From before the beginning of time, you offered love and creative wisdom as you created all that is. And in the person and ministry of Jesus, you taught us more clearly about your nature and love and gave us ways that we should live peacefully together. The Holy Spirit is offered as our guardian and our guide, faithfully with us all our days. Full and complete is your love for us, your creation. For this, we thank you. We also thank you for the many blessings in our lives. There are many. Your love for us and the justification we have because of our faith in you are the highest blessings, but there are others. Thank you, Lord. And like Paul, we know that we and those we know and love are dealing with suffering. They aren't always feeling that they can continue, and they sometimes lose hope. We lift those names to you, God, even though you know them already. Help them remember the words of Jesus when he said, I have come to bring light to a dark world. Help them feel the nearness of you, O Comforter, as they suffer. Help us, again, to be more faithful to you. Give us opportunities to witness and serve, heal and restore us. We ask these things in the name of the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer of us all, as we pray again the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is Hope of the World. Paul speaks of hope that will show us the glory. That glory is Christ crucified and risen for us.
Hope of the world, thou Christ of great compassion, speak to our fearful hearts by conflict rent. Save us, thy people, from consuming passion, who by our
And now today's benediction. Go in peace, friends. Go with the knowledge that God the Father, Jesus, God's Son, and the Holy Spirit are with you all. Speak loudly of justice. Bring peace to all you meet. Amen.